morning, Cosham Baptist Church. Welcome to today's service. Whether you're watching live, later in the day, or via the telephone, isn't it good that we can still be a church family? That's the one big element I've certainly missed in lockdown, and that's being able to physically see my family and friends. But technology has been great to keep in touch, isn't it? Even if it's just using the telephone a little bit more. Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7 says this: "Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. If you do this, you will experience God's peace, which is far more wonderful than the human mind can understand." We have such a faithful God, always there, regardless of how we're feeling, what's happened in the past, what we're going through right now, and what we're about to go through. God already knows. Our strength and our security rests in our Lord. It reminded me of the song lyrics of Faithful One, that lovely song. "So unchanging, ageless one, you're my rock of peace, Lord of all, I depend on you." God's with us every step of the way, yesterday, today, and forever. Things may be tough at the moment, definitely, we can't deny that. But the one thing that we can actually be assured of is that God is right here with us. He knows what we're going through. He loves us. He wants to take care of us. And I think that's something we just have to keep clinging to at the toughest of times, that we can be assured that God is right here with us. Let's just take a few moments now to pray. Father God, thank you that you're always there for us, regardless of how we're feeling or what's going on in our life. Lord, we pray for those going through the hardest of times right now, whether it's due to COVID-19 or another situation. Help us to remember to keep looking to you for our strength, our courage and wisdom in leaving each day as it comes. Father, we just ask that we encounter you afresh today, our living God, as we focus on Psalm 16. Lord, give us eyes to see, ears to hear, Father, and a heart that would desire more and more of you. Lord, I just pray that you will change us, Lord. I just pray that you will speak deeply into our mind and our heart today, Father, that we will not finish this service without feeling and knowing, Lord, that we have been touched by you. Lord, we pray for Wayne, Lord, as he brings your word later. Lord, I just pray that your spirit will clearly speak through him. Lord, we thank you for who you are. Lord, I just want to thank you, Lord, that you are always the same. It doesn't matter how far we may have drifted from you, Father, you are right there with us. Father, we give you all the praise and all the honour. We ask this now in your name's sake. Amen.
My lighthouse, shining in the darkness. I will follow you, oh my lighthouse, my lighthouse. I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe to shore.
Hi, my name's Kevin Mills, and I would like to give a huge thanks to the members of Caution Baptist Church for supporting myself and our family for the journey that we have been on together since we joined the church in 2003. In 2013, I was called into ministry, and it was confirmed by the members of the church at the time. And on the 6th of June this year, I was ordained as a minister within the Baptist Union. I serve now at Stafford under Beacon Church. And we really look forward to seeing what God has planned for us in the future. So once again, I want to thank you for your support, love and prayers. Blessings to you all.
Good morning, everyone. It's great that you're here. And I've got Elizabeth from CBC with me this morning. She's one of the members of the Hope into Action Friendship and Support Group. And she's going to share this morning a bit of her heart of why she's involved in this amazing ministry and opportunity that we have as a church. You know, there are many people that, you know, we can look at the world and we know that there's lots of homeless people. There's lots of vulnerable people in real need. And it can almost be too big for us to know how to deal with that. And Hope into Action is a great opportunity that God has given not just our church, but churches all over the country to actively get involved and to help those who don't have homes like many of us do. I was reminded this week of Jesus feeding the 5,000. You know, Jesus has had this time of teaching and there's these hordes of people before him, and it's coming up to dinner time. And the disciples are like, you know, we need to send these people home because there's no way we can help all of these people. And Jesus very calmly and quietly just says, it's okay. There's no need to dismiss these people. We can sort that. You know, when we look at those that don't have homes, whether they're homeless and living on the street, or whether they're homeless and they're sofa surfing or living in refuges or wherever it is, that can just be so big for us that we can't get our heads around it. And yet God says, it's okay. It doesn't overwhelm me. And if you work with me, I will help you. And that's what Hope into Action is doing. And that's why as a church, we're involved in it. And it's a wonderful and exciting ministry. Well, good morning, Elizabeth.
Morning.
It's good to see you. It's lovely to see you this morning. We heard from Bart last week, and don't worry, it's not a competition who can say the best, because my vote would go with you anyway. But he shared us about what Hope into Action is and why he wants to be involved. And I just wonder this morning if you could just share why you want to be involved in this wonderful ministry of Hope into Action.
Yes, thanks, Wayne. Well, when this first came about, I was very keen to get involved, but over the years, I have been in the church for over 30 years now, and I've always kind of thought, oh yeah, I can do that. And over the years, Edward and I have done a lot of different roles in the church. But with this one, I felt that I just needed to sit with it and pray about it and think about if I was right to volunteer. Now, just to give you a very short potted history of my life, as I say, although I've been in the church a long time and I know a lot of people, they may well not know my early life story. My father died when I was 12, and I had two older sisters, but they were married and had left home. So that left me with a fairly young mother who's widowed. We didn't enjoy the best of relationships, and I was becoming a bit of a rebellious teenager. So at 17, I moved out. I've lived in Portsmouth, various bed sits, flat shares, everything. In fact, Edward he comes from Newcastle. When he first moved down here and before we got married, he I'd drive him around Southsea and I'd say, oh, I've lived there. Yeah, I've shared a flat there. Yeah, I've had a bit of it there. So I knew quite a bit. So I've moved around quite a bit. And at the time, I didn't know the Lord at the time. So I was really involved in some quite probably unsavoury things. And my life was just really living, you know, for the weekends and what we do the weekends. So I think really, although I can't say that I was ever homeless, it wasn't until I was in my 20s that I had what I could call a home of my own. So I know what it is to kind of not belong anywhere. Somehow, I mean, I'm 66 now, but in those days it was seemed a lot easier. Maybe I'm looking back with rose-tinted specs, but it seemed easier. If you had a job, I was never out of work. You didn't like the job, you just left it and got another one. Same with flats and bedsits. If you got fed up, you just moved on. These days, I think things are maybe a little bit more difficult for the youngsters. But even so, it's remained with me that when I got my first, I was fortunate enough to get a job as a secretary in an architectural practice, and they were doing a project with a housing association, and I bought my very own first flat there, and it happened to be the practice where I met Edward as well.
That's wonderful.
So, you know, I do feel for people that are displaced or, you know, don't have somewhere that they can call home. And over the years, I've worked with people that are quite lost in terms of they have no base and they have no sort of idea of what their future is going to hold. So I do feel, so I have a heart for people like that. And again, over the years, I've got alongside people inside and outside the church. And it's been very, it's kind of been a good training ground, I think. Because I've learned a lot as I've gone along.
And I suppose that's the thing you've mentioned, that it's great to hear your story, Elizabeth, you know, and you mentioned about, you know, you had bed sits or this or that. You had, so what you're saying is you had a house or you had a roof, but you didn't have a home. And there's a big difference, isn't it? And what I like about Home Into Action is, yes, it's providing, you know, the physical house, but the church gets alongside and makes that house into a home. And home, you know, they say home is where the heart is, don't they? You know, and I think that's really important for people, you know. It's great to hear it. Now, we're hoping, aren't we, that this house is going to be ready very soon. Thankfully, there are builders that aren't us in there doing all of the hard graft, but there's lots of different people, different groups of people, if you like, that would need these homes. So who is it that we're hoping is gonna, this home from CBC is gonna be to, who's gonna be moving in?
Well, I think really we need to be open to whoever the Lord's gonna send to us. But I think possibly it might be a refugee family. I feel that we're a church family in the best sense of the word, in that we cover things for all ages. You know, we look after our older people. We've got a lot of youngsters and children's work going on. And so I think possibly it might be a family. But as I say, whoever it is, you know, we will be praying that God gives us a heart for them. And also, whatever their situation, so I always think that people deserve a second chance and maybe a third and fourth chance. And, you know, if we can offer that to someone, I think it's a brilliant opportunity.
Oh, Elizabeth, it is, it's a privilege to hear your heart for this. You can just see that you're so passionate about this. What are some of the ways that we as a church can love the house in one sense? Because we're told to love the house and love the people. So there's a practical as well as an emotional side to this ministry. So how can we as a church love the house?
Well, I think that there is a part for everybody to play, because we need practical things for them, of which there's a list. We need people to come on board on the friendship and support group, and we need prayer. Yeah. Sure, maybe I should have put that first. So even, sorry.
We know what you mean, it's fine.
Even if, you know, people feel that they can't physically help, you know, there will be something for everybody to do. Yeah. And I would love to see a big group of CBC people just coming, sort of encircling these people and and loving them and the house.
That would be great. And so just to say, if you're listening, you're watching, if you've got our church's e-news, Friday just gone, there's a piece about Hope into Action on there, and there's a button you can click and it takes you to a contents list. And on that list, it lists all the things that we need to be able to provide for this home. And if you speak to Bart, he's one of our members, he was here last week, and he will help you work out what to buy and where to put it and all of that kind of stuff. If you've got any questions, just go onto our church's website, and there's details on there where you can, if you need to contact us to ask some more information. But I would just encourage, in one sense, the contents list is a little bit like a wedding list, you know, of things that we need. And but check the list first, because obviously we don't want 8 kettles and 8 toasters, you know. So just check the list first. But please, I want to encourage you to prayerfully go over that list and to see what you could buy for that, so that we can. And that's a way, isn't it, Elizabeth, that we can all get involved in a simple yet really meaningful and powerful way, so that when those tenants walk in, they see not just, you know, this building, but they see it furnished in a lovely way that just speaks to their lives, really. So you mentioned about the friendship group. What would you say to people who are thinking about being part of the friendship and support group, but maybe they're a bit unsure, or they're just a bit fearful even about saying yes?
Yeah. Yes, I found this in the past with people in the church family, that sometimes we say, oh, you know, we need your help. And sometimes people, and I've been amongst them myself in the past, think, oh, I couldn't do that, or I haven't got the time. That's a big one. Or, you know, I don't know if that is my sort of thing. So I would encourage anyone to, yes, give Bart or myself or Miriam Sampson a ring. We'd all be happy to chat to you. It's, you know, I suppose the more there are of us, the less time maybe we need to spend. So it might be, you know, the more people there are, the less onerous it is. But it won't be onerous, because I think it's a blessing and it's a real privilege to help these people. So just give us the ring and ask.
Fantastic. And it's just because it's just about building relationship, isn't it? And I love the, you know, Hope into Action use the term the friendship and support group. It's just about being friends with these people. And that's wonderful. You did mention, you said it at the end, but I know you meant first, because you said that, but we need to pray about these things as well, because we need to, you know, love the people as well. So what do you think are some of the things? I know you're going to lead us in prayer in a moment, but what are some of the things that others could pray for us?
I think one of the things, the area where the house is, wherever it was, they've got neighbours, they're going to have neighbours. And we need to pray that they're going to be, I was going to say good neighbours, but is that the right word?
Well, I suppose it's like for all of us, isn't it? When we move somewhere, that is one of the things, you know, that we hope and pray that we're going to have good relationships with our neighbours,
And pray for the friendship and support group to grow and to get on with each other. I think we do, really, but just for the Lord to oversee that. And that we will, you know, the things on the list, the you know, the physical things that we need, that list will be, you know, taken up by people, and that we'll have everything for them, because we want them to move in, like you say, to a home that's, you know, that's got everything they need, because they may well have come from somewhere where they haven't had a lot
that's
of
right.
things.
But,
and safety, I think that's the other thing. Excuse me. We want them to be safe and feel secure where they are. and really that we can show God's love through all that we're doing.
Ah, that's brilliant. Elizabeth, it's been wonderful to hear your heart and to see you. So obviously we can't see each other physically at the moment. And I know people that are watching this from CBC will be enjoyment of seeing your face and hearing from you this morning. Would you just lead us in prayer? Would that be okay?
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes. Dear Father God, we do thank you for this opportunity that you've brought us, that we have a house in Cosham for the Hope into Action project. And we just pray, Lord, that you will go ahead of us all, that we will know what to do, where our role is, that you will encourage others from our church family to help these people. And Lord, I believe that you already have the family in mind where you are going to place them. And so, Lord, we ask you to help us with the practicalities of everything. Help us to be your hands and your feet. And just show us, Lord, the best way that we can show you to these people. And so again, Lord, it's a privilege to serve you in this way. And we just pray that you'll work through each of us and prompt those people who are thinking about joining the group. And just, Lord, give them a push in the right direction. So help us, Lord, in this project. And we want to give all the glory to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Bless you. Thank you, Elizabeth. And it's just been great to hear your heart this morning. Bless you. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Good morning, everyone. My name's Simon, one of the ministers here at Cosham Baptist. Sometimes storms come, don't they? And I'll tell you what, there was a bit of a storm this week, wasn't there? And sometimes when storms come, the floods rise. This certainly happened to us this week. Hopefully it'll be sorted next week so it doesn't happen again. But this week, my, floods came up. Didn't enter any of our houses, but they were going everywhere when we were having to stop the cars and get them to go slow. Cyclists were, well, some of them were brave and cycled through the flood. But I tell you, I was so pleased that our houses are built on solid ground, not on sand. Jesus told that great story, didn't he, of how we should build our lives on solid ground. And that solid ground is when we hear what Jesus said and we put it into practice. If we only hear it, it's like we're building on sand. And when that amount of water came, if our houses were built on sand, not sure I'd still be sitting here like this. But sometimes in life it can feel like the rain is coming. It feels like the rain perhaps is pouring. It feels like I'm trapped inside. If I just go outside, I will be soaked. Everything is going wrong. It sometimes feels, doesn't it, like it never rains, but it pours. It's not just one thing that goes wrong. It's many things that go wrong. It's not just one thing that's making me panic or wake up in the night. It's many. It's not one thing that brings me down. It's many. It doesn't just rain, but it pours. Nikki discovered this week, that it doesn't just rain, but it pours. Take a look at this.
So gonna trip. Thank you.
You may be wondering what happened to the picture. Well, let's have a look. It is well. Even when it rains, even when it pours, we can say it is well. Looking at some of the Psalms, we can see that it's because we're standing on a solid rock. Yeah, the rains may come. The rains may continue to come, but we are standing on a rock. Psalm 18, verse 31 says, "Who is the rock except our God?" Psalm 31, "You are my rock, my fortress." Psalm 78, "They remembered that God was their rock." Well, let's go back to Psalm 18 and first couple of verses. "I love you, Lord. You give me strength. The Lord is my rock and my place of safety. He is the God who saves me. My God is my rock. I go to him for safety. He is like a shield to me. He's the power that saves me. He's my place of safety. I called out to the Lord. He is worthy of praise. He saved me. Thank you, God, that you are our rock. So no matter when the waves come, no matter when the storms come, we can say it well." Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for your love, for your faithfulness, for your care. We thank you that you value each one of us. We thank you that, like the when you search for the lost sheep, you are willing to travel up high mountain to tear down every barrier, every lie, every wrong thing, everything, to rescue us, to hold us, to give us the privilege of being carried on your shoulders. Thank you that you are the good shepherd who takes care of each person. And we pray for those we know who are unwell at this time. Father, we pray for those who are isolated and lonely at this time. We pray for those who are fearful because of job insecurity, or perhaps they've already lost their job. Lord, we pray for one another, that no matter what storms may come, we will hold close to you. We will stand firm on the rock. Lord God, we give you our thanks and our praise, and we do say we love you, we thank you, we worship you. Amen.
Well, good morning. I hope you're doing well. It's lovely to see you today. I hope you've enjoyed being part of our service this morning. My name's Wayne and I'm one of the ministers at Cosham Baptist Church. Many years ago, when I was a teenager, and that's a long time ago now, if I wanted to go anywhere socially, I had a walk. My dad had died and my mum couldn't drive. And so whether that was going to scouts or going to friends' houses, going to other clubs, going back and forth to church, whether that was in the day or that was in the evening, the only way I could get there from where I was living was to walk. And it was about a mile in length to walk there. And I was okay doing that in the day, but I really didn't like doing that in the evening. I didn't like doing it in the dark. I kind of had this bit of a fear of walking in the dark on my own. And so what I used to do, if it was dark and I was walking home from scouts or a club or a friend's house or church or whatever it was, I used to talk to myself. I can't believe I just said that out loud to you this morning, but that's what I used to do. And I used to have these quite detailed and elaborate conversations with myself. And I'd get really engrossed in them, so engrossed that sometimes the conversations wouldn't just be in my head, they'd come out of my lips as well. And there was one time, maybe 35 years ago, I was walking home from somewhere. It was, I don't know, half past nine at night. And as I was walking, I was having one of these conversations. And these conversations, sometimes they were about real things going on in my life, or sometimes they were made up things going on in my life. Well, no, they weren't going on in my life because they were made up. But anyhow, you know what I'm saying. And so I was having one of these conversations and I didn't notice a man walking towards me. And so because I was so engrossed in this conversation, it felt like out of the shadows, this man suddenly appeared and it startled me. And what made it worse was he looked at me and he said, "Are you okay, mate? You're talking to yourself." At which point I just said the first thing that came into my mind, which was, well, you shouldn't be listening to other people's conversations. And at that, I just ran as fast as I could all the way home, my heart pumping, fearing that this guy was going to be following me, which of course he wasn't. You're either now thinking, I always knew there was something not quite right about Wayne. He was a little bit, I couldn't put my finger on it. He was a bit strange. Or you're thinking, I used to do that as well. Anyway, I can remember doing that very vividly. And the reason I did it was because I had a fear of being on my own, walking in the dark streets at night. Maybe it was God's training ground for me, because 35 years later, as I write sermons, I kind of preach them to myself in my head as I'm typing. So I'm kind of used to that, talking to myself. Maybe I need to stop saying all of this information about myself now. So I hope your opinion of me hasn't completely gone down. But the reason is, there are, for me telling you this silly story, is that there are things that we are all afraid of, aren't there? There are things that make us feel unsafe and insecure. And I wonder what that is for you. You know, what is it that you're afraid of? I've lost count at the number of times my kids say to me, Dad, there's a spider in the bathroom, or there's a spider in the bedroom. Can you come and sort it out for us, please? It's huge, it's huge. And when you go into their room, it is the tiniest spider that you've ever seen in your life. But maybe you're afraid of snakes or small spaces or other things like heights. My dad was afraid of heights. He really didn't like heights. And I can remember a time when he was painting all the fascia boards of the house. And he had a ladder on top of the garage. And the ladder was reaching up to the point, to the eaves. And he really didn't want to go up there. So do you know what he did? He sent my 11-year-old sister up on the ladder with a paintbrush and a tin of paint in the other hand. He held the ladder at the bottom, giving the directions of what to do and how to do it. And she was at the top, stretching as far as she could stretch to dab this paint on, because he was afraid of heights. She didn't have any fear at all. And my mum came out and could see what was going on and was speechless for a moment. And then she found her words and she told him exactly what she thought of what he was doing. But he was doing it because he didn't want to face his fear. That was a way of him dodging his fear. But we all have fears and we all do things, don't we, to help us avoid those fears. But in life, there are times when we cannot avoid our fears. And this morning we're continuing our series called It Is Well, which is looking at things that from Psalm 16, the golden secret that we heard of last week, that can help us say it is well when we're in a season of life when it's not well. And this morning we're going to hear from look at Psalm 16 verses 1-3, and we're going to hear that read to us now. Thank you.
Today's reading is from Psalm 16, verses 1-3, from the Passion Translation. Keep me safe, O mighty God. I run for dear life to you, my safe place. So I said to the Lord God, you are my maker, my mediator, and my master. Any good thing you find in me has come from you. And he said to me, my holy lovers are wonderful. My majestic ones, my glorious ones, fulfilling all my desires.
Thanks, Nigel, for reading that to us. It was a great passage that you read, and it was great to see you as well, Nigel, looking really well. Now, in these sermons over the next 5 weeks, we're not going to cover every single thing, every detail from this psalm. But over the next 5 weeks, we're going to think about five different aspects, five different themes that can help us know it's well. And this morning we're going to be thinking about what Nigel has just read to us from Psalm 16 in relation to us finding our safety and our security in life when we find ourselves in a difficult season. When we find that we're afraid because something in life has rocked us and made us feel unsteady. And as we kick off this morning, I want to say that finding our safety and our security in God doesn't mean we won't still experience those things that rock us, that make us unsteady, that we're fearful of. Because those struggles are very real and they will have an impact. You know, God can keep us safe from the COVID-19 world that we're living in, but that doesn't mean as followers of Jesus, we're not affected by it. You know, people have died, people are ill, and so on and so forth. Because as followers of Jesus, we're not immune from the struggles of life. We're not immune from the fears that we face. And as I preach this morning, I'm well aware that as you're watching or listening, there will be some of you that are going through a season of struggle. There may be some of you who are crying out to God because you're questioning, where is he in whatever it is that you're going through, and you're not experiencing his safety and security. And so as we think about what Nigel read to us from Psalm 16, I want us to be honest and real about those things that we face as well, but to say that I want us to hear today that there are ways in which we can, even in the midst of struggle, experience God's safety and security. So are you with me? Let's crack on. David starts this psalm by making a statement, and it's quite a bold and it's a confident statement. And he says, keep me safe, O mighty God. I run for dear life to you, my safe place. And so from these opening words of David, we can assume that he's in some kind of trouble or struggle, because you don't ask to be kept safe if you're not safe. Do you? Shall I repeat that? I think I said that wrong. You don't ask to be kept safe, if you're if you're not running for dear life. You're running from dear life because you're not safe. You feel unsafe. You feel unsecure. And so you're coming to God, asking him to give you a safety and a security. You know, like many of us, I can remember when I was younger being out with my friends, and you know, all of a sudden there's another group of friends, and something happens, and for whatever reason, they're chasing you. Maybe you've been in that situation as well, and very often they're older and bigger kids, and you know, you leg it, and as you leg it, you're trying to find a place that you feel safe and comfortable and familiar with, and very often that place that you're legging it to is home. Because when you get home, you find that your dad or whoever the adult is that's looking after you is there. And when you come upon them, that's when you feel safe and secure. And that's very often then when those kids that are chasing you can see that you've hit a place of safety and security, and they retreat, they back away. And David is in this position. Life has thrown something at him, and he's struggling, and yet he knows he needs to get to God. He knows his safety and security is to be found in God, and he's in a place where he can't avoid his trouble or his fear, but for him it is well because he's run to God. And we're going to come on to that and think more about that in a moment. As I say all of this, I recognize that not everybody, when you were children, had great upbringings, had good safety and security in your home life. And I know as I say these things, I'm fortunate because I did. I had when I was a child, I had a good relationship with both my mum and my dad. Home was a place where I felt safe and secure. When my dad was around, that's when I really felt safe and secure. You know, one of the things I didn't like was when Dad did night shifts and he wasn't at home, or when he was in hospital. Now, it wasn't that I didn't think Mum couldn't look after me, because she did. She did a very good job. But Dad was physically stronger. And as a kid, that made me feel safe and secure. Last year, when I was ill and I was in hospital a couple of times, the kids missed me being at home, and one of the reasons was because as their dad, I made them feel safe. They felt secure when I was there. And in this psalm, even though David is in trouble and he knows he needs God's safety and security, notice there's no tone of him being downcast. In this psalm, in his trouble, David is able to say it is well because he has complete confidence in God. And considering that David is in trouble, this psalm is quite an upbeat psalm. And you know, I think the reason for that is David knows who he is in God. That's why he's able to say out loud that God is his maker, his mediator, and his master. And you know, there's something to note here. David is confident not because he knows what God is going to do for him. He's not confident because God has given him some revelation of a way in which God's going to bring him out of this trouble. David is confident because he knows who God is to him and who he is to God. And we too need to ask ourselves those questions as we're grappling with this subject of being able to say it is well, being able to know our safety and security in the midst of trouble. And we need to ask ourselves, do we know who God is? And do we know who we are to God? And you see, for us being able to say it is well when we face trouble, when we face fear, when we're out of our comfort zones, our safety and security only comes when we know who God is to us and who we are to God. Last Sunday, before the service started on our YouTube channel, we noticed there was a man at the end of our driveway, and it looked like he was staring into our house. And it took me a few moments to realise that what he was staring at was a bird that was on our wheelie bin. And it turns out this bird was a baby crow. And he was staring at this crow because the crow had fallen from a nest, and the crow was hurt. You could see the crow was doing this hopping, come walking, come trying to fly routine, and all it could get as far as was from the wheelie bin to the roof of our car. And you could see its leg was hurt because of the way it was sort of hopping around. But there was something I noticed about that bird. It didn't seem to be distressed at all. It was very calm, and it wasn't necessarily, it didn't sound like it was crying out and running around very much at all. It was just fairly still and fairly calm. And then I realized why. Up above, circling, were two crows, adult crows. I think it's fair to say it was mummy and daddy crow. And this bird could see, even though it had fallen, even though it was hurt, it was okay because mum and dad were there. I think if it had been me who'd fallen from a nest, I would have been very distressed, but this bird wasn't. They were calling out to the crow. You could hear them calling out. I don't know what they were saying. Friends, my crow is fairly rusty. I couldn't pick it up, but I reckon they were calling out words of comfort, of affirmation, of protection, of assurance, and so on. And you see, in its time of trouble, the baby crow knew that its safety and security was in its mum and dad, because it knew who they were and it knew what it meant to them. And we can be safe and secure in God because, as the psalmist says, God is our maker, our mediator, and our master. David is reminding us that God is everything, and our whole being and every moment of our lives is known to God, and that we are so precious to God. If you go through the Bible, there are many times when God says he will help us, many times when God says we can rely on him, he will protect us, and so on. And you know, this gives me huge comfort because God knows that life is not always easy. And you see, no matter what we're facing, God says, as he did to the prophet Isaiah, don't be afraid, for I am with you. Don't be discouraged, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will hold you up with my victorious right hand. And notice again, the reason God says that he will uphold us, strengthen us, is because what? It's because he is our God. And friends, I'm laboring this point, and I know I am, because I truly want to grasp this today, not just in our heads, but in our hearts as well, because it is key to finding and knowing our safety and security in God when we find ourselves in the middle of a season of struggle or a situation of struggle. Because you will not know God's hand of safety and security if you don't know who you are to God. Many years ago, we had a lovely dog called Bron. She was beautiful. And there was one holiday that we went on, and we put Bron in kennels. We hadn't been away for 24 hours when the kennels phoned us to say that we're going to have to come home because she is so distressed. It's affecting her emotionally, and she's hurting herself trying to get out of kennels. Well, we were about 5 hours away, so we packed up the car and we drove the long 5 hour journey to where we were living at that moment in time. And it was a long and quiet drive home. And as we pulled into the kennels, we could hear Bron barking, crying and whimpering. And when she saw us, she was jumping around and she saw us, and Jem got into the back of the car and I put the dog on Jem's lap. And Bron just pushed right into Jem and instantly calmed down. Did she calm down because we were qualified vets and we could help her? Not at all. She calmed down simply because she knew who she was in us. And being with us made her feel safe and secure. She was still in pain, both physically and emotionally, but her pushing into Jem was her saying, "It is well, because I know who I am in you and that you are with me." Friends, I hope you can see what I'm saying here today. You are everything to God. You literally mean the world to him. And when you're struggling, all he wants to do is to is for you to push deeply into him and let him hold you. You know, there are times in life when we're running for dear life from something. There are times when we're in a whole heap of trouble. But in God we find safety and security because of who we are in him. And God simply holds us and says, I am your God. You know, we read in Paul's letter to the Thessalonians, but the Lord is faithful. He will strengthen you and guard you from the evil one. You see, here's the thing. Life isn't always easy. And if you're following God, there are going to be times when it feels like there are arrows being targeted at you, for the enemy does not want you to succeed. The enemy has one job, and that is to do all it can, use every trick in the book to pull you away from God. And when we're feeling the pinch of trouble, that is when we're at our weakest. But just like David in this psalm, that is exactly when we can find the safety and security in God. And that is when, even though it looks like all's gone belly up, we can still say it is well, because our troubles don't weaken or change God. God can strengthen you and guard you because he's a never-ending source of strength. You know, there's that passage from Ephesians that talks of the armor of God. We haven't got time to go into it now, but, you know, have a look at Ephesians 6, verse 10 to 15 on your own, you know, and putting on that armor of God. We need to do that because the Bible tells us that there are battles going on in what we call the spiritual realms, and we can't see them, but there are these things going on. And in those things, we need to run and stay close to God. And that passage from Ephesians, the armor of God, is like a template for knowing how we can do that. And we do that because when we are fearful, it is easiest to run from God. But it's in that moment that we need to run to God. You know, when life hits us hard, and there are times and we say, where's God now? Where is he? That's when we need to run to him and not away from him. You know, the road of the history of faith is littered with casualties of people who have fallen along the way. I know, sadly, quite a large number of people, friends, who at one time or another have been so strong in their faith. They've been the movers and shakers in a local church. They've been the leaders, the preachers. They've been the worship leaders. You know, they've been the people who others have looked up to. And yet, sadly, they too now are part of the casualties of the history of faith. And if you ask them what happened, they will often tell you a story, a season, a hurt, a pain. A season of struggle that made them, instead of running to God, they ran away from God. And often that falling away didn't happen overnight. It was gradual. But now they've walked away from God. Friends, please don't hear me wrong this morning. I'm in no way saying their pain, their season of struggle, was easy. I no doubt it was tough. It was probably one of the hardest seasons that they've ever gone through. But notice what David says in this psalm when he finds himself in the season of struggle. I run for dear life to you, my safe place. You see, David shows us in those tough seasons, God is indeed our safety and security. But to experience that, we have to be active and choose to run to God. And you know, this running to God, friends, it may simply be a hanging in there. It may be asking somebody else to pray because you don't know the words. It may be actually you're wrestling, you're arguing with God in that moment. It may be like our dog, Bron. Nothing was said, but you just rest and push in to God. And that lasts for however long it needs to last. And yes, for some, you know what? In this season of struggle, that is the moment where they feel closest to God. There's no hard and fast rules to this. There's no right or wrong, but it's just in that moment, run to God and not run away from him. Because in those times of trouble, to experience God's safety and security, to be able to say it is well, we have to be like David and run to God. Remember Horatio Spafford, who we mentioned last week? He wrote that hymn, It Is Well With My Soul, when he was at the place in the ocean on his ship where his four daughters drowned. You know, and his running to God saw him pen write one of the world's best known hymns. And I read between the lines of this story and sense that as he wrote the hymn, his tears filled the page. But through those tears, he knew God's safety and security like never before, because in that moment, he knew who he was in God. And he ran for dear life to him. In his struggle, he ran to God and not away from God. And I wonder, will we do the same? And so as I bring this to a close, I came across a paraphrase of the verse we read from Isaiah 41, verse 10, but also adding in verse 13. And it's taken from the Message Paraphrase Bible and other places. And it says this: don't panic, I'm with you. There's no need to fear, I'm your God. I'll give you strength. I'll help you. I, your God, have a firm grip on you, and I'm not letting go. If we wanted to give this sermon a title, it would be that. I'm not letting go. That's both in terms of God's not letting go of us, and we're not letting go of God. But for us, if we will run to God, we need to, you know, we will experience that there is no force strong enough to ever pull us away from him. And so when he says, I'm not letting go, we can be safe and secure that that is true. Friends, as you journey through this psalm and think about what we've been thinking about today, maybe you find yourself in a season or situation of struggle. And you really don't know how to say it is well. I simply want to encourage you. And I want to end by telling you that God will never let you go. And allow that to give you the safety and security you need in your life right now. Let's just pray together. Father, thank you that you don't leave us, that you give us all that we need in life to live life well. But Father, there are those moments, and you know that there are those moments where we face life is really hard. And it's hard to say it is well. And Father, we feel unsafe. We feel insecure. Something has unsteadied us. Something has rocked our boat, as it were. Father, in those moments, show us what we mean to you. Show us that we are the apple of your eye. Show us that we are everything to you. And may we know who we are in God and who you are to us. And Father, we just pray that in those moments, we will realize that we need to run to you and not away. And Father, if we have run away from you, Father, we know that you are there waiting to welcome us back. And may we have the faith and the courage to turn and to run to you. And so, Father, we simply pray this morning, keep me safe, O mighty God. I run for dear life to you, my safe place. Thank you and bless you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Bless you. Take care.
day when my face shall be sight, and the clouds be rolled back as the
As we end our time together, I just wanted to read something that was written by Oswald Chambers, the teacher and evangelist, about worship. It's called A Love Gift. Worship is giving God the best he has given you. Be careful what you do with the best you have. Whenever you get a blessing from God, give it back to him as a love gift. Take time to meditate before him and offer the blessing back to God in a deliberate act of worship. I hope this week is a good week for you, that you take time to pray and to read God's word, and you take time to worship God and give God the best that he has given to you. Let's end our service with a blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen.